They titled that piece in Vogue, "The Privacy of Greatness." And I've always had the feeling that you were a very private person, and yet now you seem to be coming out of your hiding place.
No, I'm not very private. I like people. I like to go out. Oh, yes, no, I'm not so private. In New York, I go out all the time and mix with the people. I like how they think, and I learn a lot from simple thinking sometimes, you know, and some sophisticated thinking. My day starts very late because in the morning I rehearse till 2-3 o'clock, you know, mm-hmm. 2 o'clock, so I take a lunch at 3. It's always late.
And you don't like to play concerts in the evening?
No.
Why?
First of all, it's the most important thing that we are living in very strange times. That there is lots of pressure, lots of tension on everybody. The traffic is very easy, lots of noise, you know, the distance are great. And usually the man is working, okay, and the woman is at house, a little bit at home, but she has lots of work now too. It's not so leisurely. So in the evening, I think people are less relaxed and more tired. When the husband comes at 6:30, 7 o'clock, sometime from the office, that tired, and the concert starts in 1 hour, so you... Bob, you know, dress, fast, take your showers at dinner, we have to go, we miss, you know. He has no time even to breathe. He goes to the concert and he rests and goes to sleep, you know. It makes no difference what you play. He's too tired, you know. You have to be relaxed because a concert is a give and take. If you don't concentrate the listener, then the performer cannot do anything very much too.
And you think today they'll concentrate better in the afternoon?
I think in afternoon they're more relaxed because it's a Sunday. They have nothing to do. Maybe they go to church, but that's not so, you know, taxing. They come back. 3-4 o'clock, they are much more relaxed. Mm-hmm. From my point of view, it's the same thing. I hate to wait the whole day, the concert. The day become for me too long. But that 8:30 in the evening, you know, and then you finish the concert at 11 and the nerves are wind up and you don't sleep well, and things like that. At 6, everything is finished. You have your friends after that, and then at 11, it's all forgotten, and you sleep like a baby, and it's finished, you know, too. And the mind, I think afternoon, we are in our best, you know, all of us.
Are you a day person?
I'm a day person.
You're a day person. You don't stay up late?
No, I stay late. I stay late. New York, I have all the time people. I like fun, too. You know, we like to be a little childish too sometime.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Everybody likes to be, you know, a few hours a day, a little bit childish, and sometime a little more, right? I can read something. I like very much young people. I like to know how they think.
You mentioned the other day when we were talking in New York that you actually had an acquaintance or a friend who was a pop musician.
Yes, that's right. Yes, it was yes. And many years ago too, I had lots of popular artists, like Mr. Levant, who died, you know. We used to be friends many years ago. We used to walk in Broadway. They would stop every time, ask him an autograph. Nobody knew me because I'm not popular, you see. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm a celebrity, but not popular. You see, that's two different things. So he said, "Don't you resent that they never ask you?" I said, I'm so happy. Let them ask you. So he all the time, if somebody asks me, but take it, this is the greatest, you take it. So I look, give me the autograph too, you know, a little bit.
Do you ever know George Gershwin?
Yes.
Did you?
Yes, I knew him. Oh, yes, very well.
Did you play any of his music?
Yes, but not in concert.
Not in public.
I play everything for me, you know, for me I play a lot of things, which I never perform, you know.
What makes the difference between what you play in private and what you play in public?
No, because I play not only piano music.
Ah.
That's the
you still
difference.
Make arrangements like...
Not arrangement, but I can play in your opera, you know, and you think at home. In Russia, they sent me the first score of the War and Peace, things like that. I studied that, and I played it. That's the opera. It goes for 4 or 5 hours. Then he changed lots of things, so I followed that. I'm interested in all kinds of music, you know. Mm-hmm. It makes no difference if it's piano or not piano. It's from 15 years old I was. Because I wanted to compose, you know, and I started to compose, but...
You were born in Ukraine.
Ukraine,
in Kiev, right?
Yeah.
Do you have personal recollections of Prokofiev that stand out?
Oh, Prokofiev I knew in Paris, not in Russia.
Yeah, that's what I mean. After Russia. You came out.
After I came out, yeah. And he went back later. I knew him about 1-2 years in Paris, quite well. So well that he once... he brought some 5-6 pieces of music in my hotel. I was a youngster at the time. And he said, I want to dedicate you to 2 pieces, which you choose. So I said, I want that etude, that scherzo, and still I have it. It's dedicated to me, it's printed. He went to all my recitals always in Paris. He wanted me to play his third concerto.
Uh-huh.
He said, don't play the second one. It's too many notes, I don't like it myself. But play the third one. I said, the third is a good concert.
Your relationship was much closer with Rachmaninoff, of course.
With Rachmaninoff was closer. Yeah. I knew him longer time. But only here, too. I didn't know him in Russia. Never.
Who were the people that we might know that you knew in Russia?
Nobody, because they all left, you know, many of them. Glazunov I knew in Russia well, in Leningrad. When I played 23... And some of the foreign artists coming. I knew Schnabel very well. He came, I met some Klemperer conductor, or some others. Those were the first foreign artists coming to Russia after the revolution.
After the revolution.
Yeah. When I was 11 years old, I played for Scriabin.
But that's all.
I don't remember.
Right.
I don't remember. Poor Scriabin. That was just before 3 hours before his concert in Kyiv. He was in concert tour. He performed probably first time his 7 or 8 sonata. It was like a nervous wreck. And was even the concert became afternoon, a little boy, you know, because brother of my father was his pupil. And one of the best. He had a medal. Mm-hmm. He studied with him in Moscow. And he... Later, after Scriabin died, and he was, by the way, 25 years the most important critic in Kharkov.
Really?
Critic of the music.
I didn't know.
Yeah, later, yeah. So he asked Scriabin, I have a nephew, and when you come to Kiev, please do me a favor. He's very talented. Please, he's 11, he's just a boy. But I think he is something, so all right. So I came, I played there, I played some. A little nothing, you know. And he said it to my mother, that I remember, he said that you do not forget one thing. He will be always a pianist, but make from him an overall cultured musician. All kinds of music, read books, read the things that, that's what he said. It is my mother follow his advice. Sure. That was very wise. He was a mystic, a philosopher himself, you know.
How did you come upon his music and become so interested in it?
Yeah, only lately. This one, I never play in Russia his music.
Yeah.
I never play. I rather Rachmaninov I play. You know, when I was 14,
sure,
15,
sure.
I remember I played all Rachmaninov, all the music. My mother was absolutely, she was pianist, my mother. And she was very much upset. She said, she would come to my teacher and said, you should play Prelude and Fugue of Bach, you should play the Beethoven sonata. I said, why you don't? My teacher would say, let him play what he likes. It will come by itself. Don't force to play anything because it has to be played. Let him play what he feels affinity with and what he likes to play in this moment. When he grows up, he will come now.
Do you think that's a good idea for today, for any pupil?
You know, not to be too rigid with people. Sometimes if they want to play Griffith or they want to play some modern music, let them play modern music. Why do they have to go through, like I call it, assembly line? And why I play Scriabin? Because it's neglected. There's only one reason. That was a composer's neglected. Rachmaninoff was very much involved because he was... exceptional virtuoso himself, mm-hmm. Exceptional pianist, exceptional everything. And he promoted his music himself. But Scriabin came here and had a very great success. I don't remember if you read about he came here, but there was a scandal. Because he came with the, here in Chicago, by the way.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I haven't heard about that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Because he came with the lady, and they were not married in the same hotel. And
here?
Yes. And at that time, it was...
Nobody does that in Chicago.
...traditional. But the country was not as today. So they asked him to leave the country. With all the success, yes, he has to leave the country. It would not happen today, no. That I assure you. But that was in 1906, something like that.
And I know that you have these composers that are neglected that you've made very much your own, like Scarlatti. I mean, like Scriabin.
Scarlatti too, I play a lot.
Clementi particularly.
And Clementi now, I start to play. You know, he has 60 sonatas, not all of them are... interesting and so, but you can perform at least 20. Mm. And you never heard, very seldom, here and there, you know, somebody comes. But first of all, I must tell you, they are not printed. Mm-hmm. And my wife finds the first edition in Italy. And I have all the first edition, all of these. I don't think many people have those. There, you see, I could see the influence on Beethoven because it's absolutely extraordinary there what is happening. In his first period, after that, he lost himself because he was squeezed between three geniuses. Right. And he didn't have so much, you know, but he was a revolutionary. Mm-hmm. I would call him Papa of piano form and piano playing. And piano playing itself, what you can do, not only from point of view of dexterity, but the point of view of sonority, it was two schools. The Viennese school was Mozart, Vienna, and Hummel. He created the other school of music, which was taken by Chopin much later, you know. Because all the pupils, all the Kalkbrenner and Reis and Moscheles, Ries and Kramer, all is his pupils. John Field, best pupil of Clementi. And he was an opera conductor. He was living in London all his life. He was born in Italy, he was Italian, but when he was 9 years old, he left and he was living in London. Mm-hmm. And he was conducting the opera. And I think he has 40 or 50 symphony, really? Which was played all the time. And they have in the old English paper, they have the critics about his symphony, just and the pair with the new Haydn symphony or new Mozart, you know, criticizing because it's better than that. But Mozart was a little bit unkind to him. And for him, Mozart was a god. And when Mozart died prematurely, his wife wanted to print the book where there was a letter from Mozart to his father. And he said that there is a very good musician by name of Clementi, but he is a charlatan like all the Italians. Mm-hmm. And he only dexterity so that tell my sister should not play his music at all. But you see, later we know that it was just youth. He was maybe 20 or 90, and he wanted to please his father. He wanted that his father, who was a musician, Leopold Mozart, he wanted rather please his father, he didn't mean that. So later he liked it, Clementi, 10 years later, so that he took the first theme from his sonata in the Zauberflöte. Magic Flute, that's Clementi. That's Clementi's sonata for piano.
Really?
Sure. Mm-hmm. Clementi was older, 4 years older. But Clementi lost himself and in a way of composition, and his last composition for me, as I understand, they're weaker because they came already after Beethoven and reached such a height, you know, that it was already less interesting. But the beginning, he opened the horizon. It's like a new light. That's why Beethoven was so interested in his music. And after he died, they find all the composition of Clementi. And Clementi was a very rich man, very prosperous man. And he invented the mechanic of the piano. He was selling the piano. And he bought the 4th, the 5th symphony, the 6th symphony. He asked Beethoven to make the violin concert for piano.
Really?
Yes, he did, and Beethoven did it. it's not very successful, you know, but he asked him. The violin concerto, make a piano version.
And yet, Clementi is not a top draw composer such as Beethoven or Mozart.
No, he's not. He's not a name, because he became a professor, he's rather exercise and things like that, but still they don't know his first composition. He has historic, tremendous value.
What do you say to people who, and I think of a lot of the younger pianists today, people who say that if you're going to be a great pianist, you should only deal with the greatest music. You should only play the
But it is the greatest music still. I think it's a very great music. Maybe they think the signature is not so great, but the music is great. That's something different. that you have to recognize. Sometimes you have a good signature, like my father-in-law said, that all the geniuses, they cannot be geniuses 24 hours. We have very weak works of Beethoven and Mozart too, you know. But the signature is good. Especially with Mozart, but his last Koschel later, from 300, 400, 500, those are absolutely formidable music, but the beginning is, I prefer Clementi. Lots of last quartet of Beethoven you could transcribe for piano. It could sound beautiful. I will not dare to do it, but you can do it. But you know what is very beautiful for piano would be? Very beautiful. It's just like written for piano, but I have no time to do it. It's a classical symphony of Prokofiev.
True.
It's just written for piano. It could be the most brilliant piece.
What do you look for in a piece if you play it for the first time that telegraphs to you that this is a piece I might be interested in?
First of all, it's emotional, spiritual conception of the work. And if you get that, then after that you read the notes. See, first you have to be some music in it, you know. And then you read the notes and then you work on all the details. But first you see the whole overall conception. You just embrace the whole work, you know. I read very well music. I have And that is important thing. That is important thing for young boys. They read very badly. Very badly. That is bad. They should read music easily.
And you have read music all the time. I mean, great quantities of music.
We used to play with Rachmaninoff four hands, all the symphony of Haydn, of Bruckner, of everything. Always four hands play, you know. I knew the music without the orchestra before, but the music itself. See, we didn't have orchestra good during the revolution. I knew the Brahms music, all the things, but nobody performed it there. But I knew it playing by four hands and things like that with good musicians of that time, like Mr. Neuhaus, who was a very great teacher. He was my friend. We gave a concert with him on two piano. Yes. He was the teacher of Giles and Richter.
Really?
Sure.
But this was your friend? Yeah.
He was my greatest influence, maybe.
Really?
Yeah. He died maybe, I don't know, 7, 8 years ago, or 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. He was the nephew of my teacher. Cousin or what? Something, I don't know.
One of those.
That's the same family. You see, my teacher, Blumenfeld, was married. Szymanowski was one of the cousins of them. It's all Polish family. They were friends of Rubinstein too. Neuhaus, great friend of pianist Rubinstein. Arthur, not the Anton. But my professor was a friend of Anton Rubinstein. Very great friend of him. He was with them together lots and playing for hands too, and he knew everything. So that means Anton Rubinstein is a little bit my grandfather teacher, you know.
I have people who in the older generation who will tell me that there were probably three virtuosos, Liszt, Anton Rubinstein, and yourself.
You know that there were another one, Tausig, who died very young, from 32. Mm-hmm. He was a very great, very great. And I have a very interesting, I just read now in Russian, the letter between Liszt and Anton Rubinstein.
Tell me.
It's a very interesting. I don't know how to translate that. But Anton Rubinstein is writing to Liszt, was living already in Weimar, and he was an elderly man. He didn't appear concert so much. And Anton Rubinstein was conducting in Vienna, and he has to conduct one of his cantata, of Liszt cantata. He wanted him to be present in the rehearsal, Anton. And he's writing him a letter, and then in this letter he condolences about the death of Tausig, which was the best pupil of Liszt. And he said that that's terrible, that such a great musician like this, and who is left now? He said, only you, me, my brother, Nikolai Rubinstein, too. And Hans von Bülow, he called. He was great.
Conductor, pianist.
Pianist, yeah. All, yeah. So we four. And then he said that, you know, and this kind of virtuosity and musicianship which Tausig had, it is very interesting, he said. It's like in politics, he said it a little bit. What is written in music is a law. We are interpreting the law. The music doesn't go forward by good musicianship only. Good musicianship could be right, center, and left, like in politics, you know. But the good performer has to be a dictator. And he said, I can write to you more and more, but I don't want to impose my... And that's very interesting, because those people, they were something plus. He wanted to tell, because Germany was a little academic for him.
Mm-hmm. The dictator, as opposed to the academic.
He said that the art goes by a dictator, mm-hmm. who dictates. He revolutionized the music, like Wagner or things like that, you know. He was a dictator. He did what he wants, you know. But not who copies, who little, you know, little piece here, little piece there. In that, he called it dictator, not like we call it dictator now, you know.
Yeah,
but
sure.
At that time, there were no dictators. Maybe he didn't use the right words. But it's true, it's not enough to be a good musician. That I agree. As a performer. You have to combine good musician is non plus ultra. You have to be. If you are not, you should not go on the stage.
What else does it take?
You have to recreate the work. As I told you, the sound came before the word.
Yes, that's one of my favorites.
Yeah.
Chopin said that.
Yeah, the sound came before the word. It's very difficult to describe music with words.
Yes.
I think the music and painting, they are two most difficult things to describe with words. I think it's impossible.
I do too.
The most difficult thing, because painting too, what you see there, somebody feels and see it different. Mm-hmm. Theater, yes, which is word, you can criticize and describe by words. Already opera even is already closer. Ballet, half. But it's closer still, because it's pantomime, is, you know, it's something, yes. So. But music, the sound by itself tells you what it is. Mm-hmm. Combination of sound, the structure of sound, the spiritual, the emotional, there's so many things there, you know. And period, when it was written, for instrument it was written. And why does it sound this way, not this, and what the instrument was, you know. Like piano was in those times, everyone was complaining that they are not singing tone. For me, it's the most important thing in piano.
Singing tone.
Only. That's number one of everything. My inspiration comes always from song, from voice. I have more records of old voices than piano recordings. I have all the voices, all the baritone, the, everything, all the opera, everything you can imagine. I sit nights and days and listen to the opera.
Operas?
This is why when you bring your piano into a concert hall like Orchestra Hall the other day, you take such care put it where it belongs.
Yeah. It's a singing tone and colors, because I wanted to get away from percussiveness from the piano. Because if you play percussively only, it's not an individual. The piano is like an orchestra. It has all the kind of shadings and sounds which you could imitate in your imagination, but not imitate. You cannot play like flute, you cannot play like a boy, you know, but have it in mind, you play with different color. Quasi-oboe, quasi this, like many composers write that, quasi-oboe, quasi-trumpet, quasi this, you know, quasi. But you have 88 notes, nearly the whole orchestra.
Do you sometimes orchestrate them in your head?
I could.
I mean, specifically? Or
no, I orchestrate in me.
Yeah, no.
Oh, sure.
Yeah?
Yes, in me. I feel different colors, you know. The colors in orchestration, just that's what you cannot describe with words.
Yeah, pardon of me. Course. Forgive me
you
for asking.
A terrible thing. That's what is difficult. I don't know right or wrong. I don't know if it exists right or wrong. But what is important is to strive for it. That is important, and not to use it as a percussive instrument to play with good dexterity, with even scale and things. That you don't have that to be on the stage, because it will be boring. 5-10 minutes will be the same thing. In 1 hour, you have to play 2 hours recital. Mm-hmm. So it's not interesting. You have to have something more of it. And the real artist who does have success, I have lots of illustrious colleagues, they have something to say. You know?
It's interesting that you have a very, you know, when we've talked before, you have a very clear understanding of what you mean by spirit, what you mean by heart, what you mean by means. I've read before things that you've said about that. You've been saying it as long as I've known anything about you. I still can't quite tell where the boundary is between spirit and heart.
Heart is interpretation. Spirit is a composition.
I see.
That is the difference. You talk about two things.
Spirit is in the music.
Spirit is in the music.
In the score.
In the score. And you have to be faithful to the spirit of the music and convey it to the public as a messenger. That is something different. But heart, you feel it in music and you have it in you. If you don't have it, then you cannot project that. And there you are a little bit more free. You could be one day better. Your pulse is one day like this, the other day like that. That is changed by everybody, moods and things like that, how you feel. But that is two different things. One is composition, and second is the interpretation. First, spirit, I understand, is the composition. Mm-hmm. You have to have a conception of what the composer wanted to say with that. The other, the feeling, the eloquence and things, that is interpretative quality, which are physical too, you know. You have to have a good touch to know how to differentiate the notes and to play piano. After all, I play piano, but you know the name of that is pianoforte.
Yes.
Pianoforte is the ability to play piano and forte. And what is in between?
Yes.
It's not to play, if you play only one, only forte, or only piano, only mezzo forte, only mezzo piano, then you are bored in 15 minutes. It has to be color, it must be change of thing, and that's what makes music interesting, and that's what the composer wanted.
I think so.
There is no question about it, especially the Romantic period. I think not only Romantic, starting from Beethoven already. Mm-hmm. But starting from Mozart, he wanted to sing too. He didn't have means. So Beethoven was very critical. He said, we should not play like in Mozart time, because he didn't have means. But we have a better piano, which came from Clementi, you see. Mm-hmm. That's how the music started to develop. So he started to develop left hand, more basses, more dynamic, more chords. So the music started to get more, so the spirit started to change in music. And the interpreter had to find out how to do it. Then you have to have conception and things like that. So
I haven't forgotten. At the press conference the other day, and just at the end, one of the reporters from the piano magazine confronted you and said something like, Mr. Horowitz, forgive me for asking this, how do you achieve this marvelous technique? And your response was, I do not have marvelous technique.
I do not, it's true.
And I think everybody at that moment in the room, you could feel the eyebrows go up.
No, because it mixed up the technique and mechanic. It's two different things. technique in general, it's savoir-faire in French. Mm-hmm. It's know how to do it. It's know how to do piano and forte, how, when it's for singer technique, it's very important to take a high note and stay until from 340 to 3 piano, you know, gradually this is technique. The quality of a voice, that's something different. That's given by God, you know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But the mechanics, when they ask me, you have such a technique, they taught mechanics. That I play fast octaves, that I can play fast trills, that I play fast arpeggios, I can play fast. That I don't have the best. I have my many colleagues who are much more advanced than me. I cannot do it. I sometimes listen to them. I cannot do the things like what they do. But when you listen to me, I have so many colors to do that, that it seems to you that this is, it is true. It is like that.
You'll have to talk me into it.
and I have a technique I have.
Yes.
Yes, I'm humble enough, you know, to tell I have a good technique. I know the piano, because otherwise I would not play the instrument. I'm born myself first. If I cannot do it, I'm born. If I something think I cannot do with the thing, then I leave it alone. I cannot do that.
When you and I were talking in New York, you were saying that if you had your ideal record, it would be the one which...
To play by the same piece?
The same piece.
The same piece four times on the same record, yeah. With space of 4 or 5 weeks, 2 months, 3 months. And so it's just to release. And Chopin writes in his letter, when some of my people bring me my own pieces to play for me and they try to imitate me, I send them home because I want that they bring something from their own understanding of my, not like I play. Because I never play twice the same. For me, the music is very easy, you know.